Hi friends, welcome back to another session of PC Made Easy. After looking into the properties of PN junction and its characteristics, now it is time to get into another interesting device called a Zener diode. The basic operation of Zener diode is during the reverse bias. Nothing special in the forward bias. In the forward bias, it is same as our PN junction, but the difference we find is when it is reverse biased. And this difference is seen because of some thing called a breakdown. When we are working with a diode, when it is reverse biased, so we have a P layer, we have a N layer, then it is reverse biased, that is negative terminal applied to P side, positive terminal applied to N side. A small number of electrons are there in the P type of material, that is because of thermally agitated electrons stripping covalent bond, creating electron hole pairs. On the same ground, few holes are available on the N side. Whereas on the P side, very large number of holes are available because of adding impurity, the trivalent atoms. Whereas a large number of free electrons are available on the N side because of the N pentavalent impurity being added here. But when it is reverse biased, the impurities added are not going to make much difference because they are going to contribute only in the forward direction. In the reverse direction, it's only the charge carriers which are generated because of thermal agitation are going to be participating. And because these are in very small number, so let us start calling them by the size. So it can be majority carriers and minority carriers. The majority carrier, if you talk about N-type material, majority carriers are electrons and minority carriers are holes, because few holes are generated because of thermal agitation. And the same way, if you talk about P-type material, holes are in majority because a lot of impurity atoms of trivalent type are added here, and that are going to create only holes, not electrons with them. But very few electrons are generated because of thermally agitated covalent bond breaking, and small number of electrons are available. So we call minority carriers in P type is electron, minority carrier in N type is holes, and these are going to contribute in the forward bias, and these are going to contribute in the reverse bias. That's what we had seen in our previous case. But the situation is, the voltage you applied, you just keep on increasing. So as you keep on increasing, and we have seen in our previous lecture, these free charge carriers will get a higher and higher acceleration, higher and higher velocity, may contribute to higher current, but because of very small number, this current is very, very small. But there comes a situation where this voltage reaches to extremely high level. When you have extremely high reverse voltage applied, then something called breakdown occurs. So what is this breakdown called? There are two types of breakdowns. One we call avalanche and the other one is called a Zener breakdown. Avalanche breakdown, something to do with the kinetic energy, and Zener breakdown to do with the potential energy. What's happening is few electrons are available here for conduction and they keep contributing for the current, right? Now voltage is applied, so some current is flowing, and because of this flow of current, then what would happen? Increase in voltage will increase in velocity, so increase in current. So that's a regular issue, but when the voltage goes extremely high, then these velocities are too high, and when these electrons are moving with a very high velocity, they bombard with the atoms on the way. They collide with the atoms on the way, and this creates disturbance in the atom. And because of this disturbance, some electrons break covalent bond. And hence, an electron hole pair is created. So one electron was moving, it hits one atom, atom gets disturbed, one electron gets sufficient energy to break the covalent bond, and because of which it becomes free. Now instead of one electron, two electrons started flowing, and along with that one more hole started contributing. So two electrons and one hole moving in opposite directions are going to contribute in the same way to the flow of current, and because of which the current will increase. So electrons increased, holes increased, and hence current increased. Increase in current in the other way, you can say more and more charge carriers are available for further bombarding with other atoms. So now earlier few electrons were bombarding. After bombarding, more electrons released, and all electrons together continue to bombard, and because of which further more electrons get released. So it's something like one started with two, two become four, four become eight, and that way they continue and it grows indefinitely, and this is called an avalanche effect. This is called avalanche effect. This is similar to the avalanche we find in snowy hills. A small part of snow, if it starts rolling down the hill, then while rolling down, it disturbs other snow on the way, and these disturbed particles will continue to move with this falling snowball, and with this the size of the ball keeps growing and growing and growing indefinitely, and by the time it travels some distance, when it has started with a small handful size of a ball, and by the time it reaches down the hill, it might be big enough to destroy one whole village. So that's what is the effect of avalanche, and similar thing can be seen here. So that's what is our process called breakdown, avalanche breakdown. This is because of kinetic energy is there in the electron. They hit the atom. Because of this, some electrons in the covalent bond of that atom get sufficient energy to break the covalent bond, and because of which they start moving, and their motion gets accelerated because of the applied voltage, and this accelerated electrons can further bombard with other atoms that will contribute to another release of electrons, and this keeps going on and on and on, and every time the number of free electrons made available for conduction keeps increasing, and hence the current keeps growing and growing and growing. So this process continues as long as the device can withstand the current, because with the current heat gets generated, and as long as this device can tolerate that heat, it continues to do, but at one time it gets destroyed because of very high heat energy. So that's one way of breakdown. The other way is using the potential energy. So when you apply higher and higher voltage here, then higher electric potential is created across the region, and this electric potential is pulling the electrons in its direction, and this pull of electrons by the electric field is being opposed by the covalent energy, and once this energy is sufficiently large to break the covalent bond, then these electrons become free. And this way, as you increase the voltage, the electrons become free. So with a high potential applied, the potential energy available at atoms is so strong that it can pull the electrons from the covalent bond from the atoms and make them free. This process is called a Zener breakdown. This is because of the potential energy. So the two effects are always there together. So because of high potential energy, more free electrons are created, and because of this high potential energy, larger kinetic energy is created, because they get accelerated. This higher kinetic energy colliding with the atoms will create more number of free electrons, and that avalanche effect. So it starts with a Zener, ends with an avalanche. And if we can make this process to be under control, that means you just make sure that this happens within a small voltage range, and that voltage range is not enough to heat up this and burn the device, so it can be done in a controlled way. So this is possible when we go for heavily doping. Now if you keep this breakdown under tolerable limits, then we can make more wonders to happen. And how that can be done is what we are going to see now. So that whole thing depends on the doping level. You talk about a semiconductor, P-type, N-type, and so if you are talking about a intrinsic semiconductor, then there Fermi levels are at the center. But as you increase the concentration of impurity, as you increase the concentration of impurity, then what's going to happen? So with a lightly doped, this level goes a bit low, this level goes a bit high because more free electrons are made available here and more holes are made available here. Therefore, the Fermi level goes down towards the valence band here, and whereas here it goes towards the conduction band. As you keep increasing the concentration, if the concentration becomes more and more, this keeps moving more and more towards the bands. This goes towards valence band, this goes towards conduction band. So when you started and when there no impurity added, this is how the two energy bands, two sides of the energy band could look. But as you keep adding impurity, then this would happen after a small impurity added. And if you further increase the impurity, this would further increase. If you increase further, then it will increase further. Maybe this is the situation where we are talking about a simple PN junction where the Fermi levels are somewhere here. Fermi levels are here, so that they are not very close to the bonds. But yes, they are near to it, not very close to the, this is not very close to valence band, this is not very close to conduction band, but yes, they are near to it compared to this one where they were in the center. Now if you keep increasing this process of increasing the concentration, then this will continue and will become this. Now our Fermi level may be here, so very much close to the bands. So this is the situation where we can find some special effects, and this effect when you talk about reverse bias, under reverse bias, few minority carriers are here which are electron in p-type, holes in n-type, and this few charge carriers will contribute for the current. So these electrons will participate in this flow of current, and because this size is very small, a small amount of current will be flowing. But as you increase this potential beyond some level, because they are heavily doped, we can find very large number of impure atoms in this, and these large number of impure atoms can contribute for free charge carriers. Simple. When you say pentavalent atom, then it is not necessary that each pentavalent atom can contribute the fifth electron for conduction under normal conditions. But as the voltage applied increases, then the pull to that electron will also increase because of the electric field applied, and that pull may be sufficient to pull it out and become free. Under normal condition, thermal agitation may not be sufficient to do it. Pull here can do that. So because of that, you can expect a Zener breakdown. Because this is heavily doped, you find large number of pentavalent atoms here, and these large number of pentavalent atoms will have a large number of fifth electrons in their outermost orbit, and with this small increase here, you can expect large number of free electrons getting released because of Zener effect, and these large number of electrons start contributing to the current, and this contribution of the current can continue and create avalanche effect, and hence you can find a large number of current, large amount of current flowing, and this happens at a tolerable under tolerable conditions, and this is not going to create indefinite amount of heat, and hence the device does not get destroyed or get disturbed, but still you can find a flow of current. So in normal times, the current in the forward direction appears to be this, and in the reverse direction it was something like this earlier. This is for PN junction, but when it comes to the new one, which we called diode with heavy doping and with a small increase in voltage, if it can produce a large amount of free charge carriers because of Zener effect, and this free charge carriers creating current and contributing to avalanche effect, in all will have a large current to flow, and because of which, though in the beginning there is no change you find between the normal PN junction and this one, but when you reach one level where this Zener breakdown occurs, then you can suddenly see a large current surging, and this voltage is the Zener breakdown voltage. This happens in the reverse direction. In the forward direction it behaves same as our PN junction, but in the reverse direction, till some level it doesn't allow current to flow, but after that level it just becomes open and allows large current to flow, because large amount of carriers are now made available, first because of Zener effect, next because of avalanche effect. Both together will contribute to large amount of current to flow. So now if you look at the reverse side of the operation, then you can say that if the input applied in this polarity, if it is less than VZ, then no current. So you can say it is open circuit, and when V becomes greater than VZ, then large current will flow, which you can say is similar to a short circuit. Yeah, another wonder we have seen. The same device sometimes behaves like an open circuit, sometimes behaves like a short circuit in the reverse direction. Whereas if you just talk about an ordinary junction diode, then in one direction behaves like a conductor, other direction behaves like a insulator.